Yeah, any doubt in your previous lectures?
No, sir.
Okay.
No, sir.
Okay, so yesterday we have stopped at this point.
Yes, sir. Functions
Yes,
mode.
sir. So clear about functions, methods, modules, packages, and library. What do you mean by function? What do you mean by method? What do you mean by module? What do you mean by package? What do you mean by library? I hope this is clear to all.
Yes.
Okay, so now we are moving to lexical resources. So the very first term that comes over here is a lexicon, and it's very important in NLP. A lexicon or lexical resource. It is a collection of words or phrases along with associated information, such as part of speech and sense definitions. So it means you can consider it like a table, right? In Word, you have made a table in which first column represents the word, and the second column or further columns represent the information related to that word, right? In which it can be the translation of that word in some language, or part of speech, or sense definitions, so anything. So, thus, a lexicon or lexical resource is a collection of words or phrases along with associated information such as part of speech and sense definitions. So, lexical resources are secondary to texts and are usually created and enriched with the help of text. For example, if you have defined a text, my underscore text, then vocabulary will be, we are enclosing the text, that is my underscore text, in the function set and then sorted. So then it means we are finding the unique words in my underscore text, and then we are sorting it as well. So this output will be stored in the variable vocab. So what it is doing, it is building the vocabulary of the text my underscore text. And if you talk about the FREQDIST function, so it is providing us the frequency also. Right, and word underscore frequency, basically this is generating the dictionary in which key value pair is there. So key is your unique word and value is your count of that word occurring in the text. So counts the frequency of each word in the text. So both vocab and word underscore frequency are simple lexical resources. Similarly, a concordance like the one what we have seen in the very first lecture gives us information about word usage that might help in the preparation of a dictionary. Got it? So what is a lexical entry? A lexical entry consists of a head word, also known as lemma, along with additional information such as the part of speech and the sense definition. So it means, suppose we are talking about a stammer, we are developing a stammer. So we'll be having stemming rules, right? So we are writing the root word in the first column. And then you are writing what are the possible inflections according to the part of speech. So this, the one row becomes your one lexical entry, right? And head row becomes your root word or a lemma. So if two distinct words having the same spelling, what are they called? Homonyms. So what is homonym? If two distinct words have the same spelling. Any idea is coming to your mind? Can you give me an example of homonym? two distinct words having the same spelling. Okay, you just find out from the net and let me know tomorrow. The simplest kind of lexicon is nothing more than a sorted list of words. If we are storing the list of words in the text file, that is also a lexicon. Sophisticated lexicons include complex structure within and across the individual entries. So in the coming slides, we'll be looking at some lexical resources that are included with the NLTK. Any doubt in it?
No, sir.
So you can see the lexicon terminology over here in this figure. The lexical entries for two lemmas having the same spelling, they are called homonyms. They are providing the part of speech and the gloss information. So see, we have taken the example of saw that we are taking previously, we have taken in the previous word sense disambiguation concept. So this is head word or lemma. And each row is represented one lexical entry. So in this lexical entry, we have provided the part of speech. So it can act as a noun, it can act as a verb. So then some sense definition or gloss about that. So if you talk about saw and it is a verb, so it means this is past tense of see. And if you talk about saw, that is acting as noun, so it is cutting instrument. So these are homonyms. I hope this is clear to you.
Yes, sir.
Then we come to the word list corpora. NLTK includes some corpora that are nothing more than word list. So the words corpora is simply in Unix, if you talk about from Unix, so this is the folder. USR dict words file from Unix used by some spell checkers. So here, can you tell how the spell checkers utilize this word list corpora for checking the spellings? Any idea? Can you guess about that? So you may explore minimum edit distance algorithm. Any idea about that minimum edit distance algorithm?
Yes, Dijkstra algorithm.
So if you are checking the words within the document one by one and you are comparing with the word list, so with the minimum distance algorithm, you can find if there is a variation of spellings over there. And if there are, you can, the software will give you the suggestions that it may be this word you may select among the suggestions that the system has given. Is it clear to all?
Yes, sir.
So we can use it to find unusual or misspelled words in a text corpus. So how can you filter a text? So let's see the following program. What is this program? This program computes the vocabulary of a text. We know how to compute the vocabulary of a text. Fine. In which what we are doing, we are first lowercasing all the words. Fine. And then we are doing set. Then we are doing sorting. So then we are finding the vocabulary. Then removes all the items that occur in an existing word list, leaving just the uncommon or misspelled words. So let's see how we can do that. So we have defined one function. In the very first line, we have written def unusual underscore words in bracket. We are passing on the text to this function. We have defined one variable text underscore vocab, in which what we are doing, we are first lowering all the words, right? And we are writing a loop over here. For w in text, if w dot is alpha. So what is this w dot is alpha? Can you tell me what it is doing. W dot is alpha.
Sir, used to find alphanumeric words.
Only alphabetic.
Only alphabetic.
Only those words. Okay. Only those words that are having alphabets.
Yes, sir.
So we are removing all the punctuation words. We are ignoring all the numeric words. We are only considering the alphabets over here, the words with alphabets. Fine. So W dot is alpha. So it is filtering all those words. And then further, we are doing the lowercase. We are converting them into lowercase. And then we are finding the unique using set. Got it? So this vocabulary is being stored in text underscore vocab. In the second line, English underscore vocab, what it is doing? It is accessing the words from the corpus words. W for W in nltk.corpus.words.words. So here you should not confuse yourself. This words is the name of the corpus. And words is the function what we have called that is available with us in NLTK for finding the words from the corpus. So then we are lowercasing and then we are finding the unique through the set function. And this is stored in the English underscore vocab. Got it? So first is, for in the first line of code, we have text with us from where we have found the unique words. We have generated the vocabulary. In the second line of code, we are having the standard corpus words from where we have generated the vocabulary. So we have two variables with us, text underscore vocab and another is English underscore vocab. And how can you find out now unusual or misspelled words? So see the third line of code, unusual equal to text underscore vocab dot difference English underscore vocab. So now what it is doing? We are returning the sorted list of unusual variable, whatever output we have received. So when you want to display it, so what we are doing? Unusual underscore words. What you need to pass? What you need to pass to it? So some corpus. So nltk.corpus, Gutenberg.words, and then you have to pass on some file ID out among the Gutenberg file IDs. So then it has returned us the list of unusual words. So similarly, you can have nltk.corpus. From chat also you can find out the unusual words or misspelled words. So any doubt in this program, whether you are able to understand filtering a text or finding out uncommon or misspelled words?
Sir, what is dot difference doing?
If there is a difference between standard English words that is available with the words corpus and this is the text corpora what we have picked from the number of sources, like we can say news corpora, we can talk about like Gutenberg we have used over here, okay, news chat we have used over here, right? So you are comparing with the words list that we have extracted from the standard word list.
Okay, sir.
Got it?
Yes,
so
yes.
We can take an example that this words we can consider, right? The words corpora is your English dictionary. That is the standard one. It is having correct English spelling words. Okay. You are comparing the words that we have extracted from some unknown corpora. And then you are finding the difference. If there is difference, so they comes out to be unusual words. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Next is, there is also a corpus of stop words. So can you let me know what you mean by stop words?
Yeah, full stop, like that, sir.
Very common words. Is, am, the, an, right? So these are the stop words, full stop, comma, right? These are the stop words. So there is also a corpus of stop words that is, and how you can define, they are of high frequency words, because the, to, also, they are coming with very high frequency in your text. And that we sometimes want to filter out of the document before further processing, because they are not contributing other than, no doubt they have the special meaning and the special place in the document, but when you are processing it, sometimes we need to filter it out. So stop words usually have little lexical content, and their presence in the text fails to distinguish it from other texts. So sometimes we can say, if we are putting the along with some word, so, and there is a single word, so we are not able to compare it. So what we make our text at one platform by filtering out other stop words from the document. So we have a list of stop words with us, and the corpora is also available. From nltk.corpus, import stop words. Then stop words is there for number of languages. So stop words for dot words, and we are putting on the language over here, English. So it is displaying all the stop words that are available for the English language. So is it clear? We have imported the stop words corpora, and then we have extracted the words for the English language. So let's define a function to compute what fraction of words in the text are not in the stop words list. Right. So we are defining a function def content underscore fraction, and we are passing on the text into it. Stop words. First, we have extracted all the stop words into the stop words variable. Then we are finding the content. So for w in text, if w dot lower not in stop words, right? Not in stop words. If they are not stop words, then it will go into the content variable. And then you are finding the fraction by dividing length of content divided by length of text. So in this way, you will be getting the fraction of words in the text that are not the stop words in the stop word list. So then you are calling upon this content under fraction, and you are passing some list of some corpus. Fine. So then this percentage comes out to be 66% approximately. Is it clear to all? Know about stop words?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then is wordlist corpora. Thus, with the help of stop words, we filter out approximately a third of the words of the text. So notice that we have combined two different kinds of corpus here, using the lexical resource to filter the content of a text corpus. So let's look at this problem over here. How many words of four letters or more can you make from those shown here? So this is a very good, you know, sometimes you have the puzzle kind of thing over here, right? So can you write the program like this? It is a puzzle in which you have been given this kind of problem to you, and you have to find how many four letter words you can make out of it. And each letter may be used once per word. Each word must contain the center letter, and there must be at least one 9-letter word. So no plurals ending in S, no foreign words, no proper names. So these are the conditions that you have to put, and you have to do this. So is it interesting?
Yes, sir.
And through NLTK, you can program it. And through NLTK, you can program it. Fine. So whatever we have learned earlier, they can be used over here to do this. So we will be seeing, I think the program will be shown like that. So a word list is useful for solving word puzzles, such as one that we have shown in the figure. So our program iterates through every word for each one, checks whether it meets the conditions. Is it fine? Then it is easy to check obligatory letter and length constraints also. It is trickier to check that candidate solutions only use combinations of supplied letters, especially since some of the supplied letters appear twice. V is coming two times, right? So the frequency distribution comparison method permits us to check that the frequency of each letter in the candidate word is less than or equal to the frequency of corresponding letter in the puzzle. So let's see. Puzzle underscore letters equal to NLTK dot frequency, and you are providing all the letters over here. E, G, I, V, R, V, O, N, L. Then what is the obligatory letter? R. How can you generate the word list? NLTK.corpus.words.words, right? Then you are writing the loop. What are you doing? You are filtering out those words and making a loop for W in word list. First condition is if the length of the word is greater than or equal to 6. Second condition, obligatory in W. In that word, R should be there, must be there, not should, must be there. And they must come once. So NLTK dot frequency less than or equal to puzzle letters. So in this way, you have put all the three conditions. You have filtered out all the words from the word list. And these are the letters that you have generated. Isn't it easy and interesting?
Yes, sir.
Can you try at your home with different kind of use cases? Fine. Different taking examples. Then one more word list corpora is the names corpora, containing 8,000 first names categorized by gender. The male and female names are stored in separate files. Let's find names that appear in both files. Names that are ambiguous for gender means the names that are that can be name of a male member, that can be the name of a female member. So first, what we are doing is we are extracting the names from the names corpora, right? No, sorry. We are keeping the names short name. Names equal to nltk.corpus.names, then names.fieldids. So we have two field IDs, female.txt and male.txt. We are extracting the names, male names in the male underscore names variable by using words, female by using words and giving female.txt, in the above giving male.txt. Then W for W in male underscore names, if W in female underscore names. If the word is coming in both the files, so then we are displaying it onto the screen. So this is the, these are the common names that can be used for males and females. Is it clear to all?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Then you can generate the plot, right? So it is well known that names ending in letter A are almost always female. So that you can also just find out. We can see this and some other patterns in the graph. So this figure shown produced by the following code. Remember that name minus one is the last letter of the name because we are starting from the end. Fine. So CFD equal to NLTK dot conditional frequency, what we are pass, it requires file ID and name from the last. So we are looking at what is the last character coming in the names. So for file ID in the names dot file IDs, for names, for name in names dot words file ID. So for each file ID, it is playing something, right? It is picking first female.txt, display, plotting the graph, then picking male.txt, plotting the graph. So from here, you can see, if you talk about this A, so in the case of female, it's a peak, big peak, right? And for the in the case of male, it's very less. And here you can see in the case of D, so it's very high. F very high. So in this way, you can do some interesting, plays with the data. Then is the pronouncing dictionary. A slightly richer kind of lexical resource is a table or a spreadsheet containing a word plus some properties in each row. So NLTK includes a CMU, pronouncing dictionary from US English, which was designed for use by the speech synthesizers. We know what is speech synthesis. So speech synthesizers. So what we are doing is nltk.corpus.cmu.dict, and we are extracting the entries, and entries go into the entries variable. We are finding the length of the entries. It comes out to be 1,27,012. And we are then writing a loop statement for entry in entries. And we have given some range and print entry. So it is printing the entry. So fir for ER1. So the pronunciation is also written over here. So how it is like? So F will be speaking as for. Air means air. Fire. Fire. Like this. Like. So this you have a list, and in which first how each letter is being pronounced over here, it is mentioned in that. So for each word, this lexicon provides a list of phonetic codes, distinct labels for each contrastive sound known as phones. So observe that fire has two pronunciation in English. One syllable F R AR and the two syllables FARO. So the symbols in the CMU pronunciation directories are alphabet described. We can just go through our alphabet over here in this website. Each entry consists of two parts, and we can process these individually using a complex version of the for statement. So instead of writing for entry in the entries, we replace entry with two variables, word and pronunciation. Now, each time through the loop, word is assigned the fourth part of the entry and pronoun is assigned the second part of the entry. Let's see. For word, comma, pronoun, prone is, they have kept the another variable in entries. So if length of the pronunciation is equal to 3, so PH1, PH2, PH3 equal to prawn. And if PH1 equal to P and PH3 equal to T, so print word, comma, PH2. So in this way, the program works like this. This program just shown scans the lexicon, looking for the entries whose pronunciation consists of three phones. And if the condition is true, it assigns the content of the prompt to the three new variables, phone 1, phone 2, phone 3. And notice that the unusual form of the statement that doesn't work. Then is comparative. Sorry. Comparative word lists. Another example of a tabular lexicon is the comparative word list. NLTK includes a so-called Subdesh word lists of 200 common words in several languages. The languages are identified using ISO 639 two-letter code. Like if you talk about, so BE, BG, BA, CA, CS, CU, so these are the name of the countries. On the basis of this, the language has been mentioned. So these are the file identifiers. So from nltk.corpus, import Subdesh, Subdesh.file IDs, Subdesh.words, and you are mentioning inside the language, that is EN. So we can access cognate words from multiple languages using the entries method, specifying a list of languages. With one further step, we can convert this into a simple dictionary too. So fr to en, so subdesh.entries fr.en. So here you can see I in English is J in French. So in this way, you can do a translation kind of thing. So small translation system can be developed over here. You can find, so if you want to develop French to English, so you're providing the French word, it is giving you an English word. So we can make our simple translator. So you can develop a translator also. So this is German English and this is Spanish English. So in this way, you can just develop the translator as well. So can you see how interesting it is to develop a simple translator using the inbuilt comparative word list available in NLTK? Then is shoebox and toolbox lexicons. Perhaps the single most popular tool used by the linguists for managing the data is toolbox, and previously it was known as shoebox. Since it replaces the field linguist's traditional shoebox full of file cards, so toolbox is freely downloadable. So I advise you all to kindly visit this website and explore about this toolbox as well. So a toolbox file consists of a collection of entries where each entry is made up of one or more fields. Most fields are optional or repeatable. What it means that this kind of lexical resource cannot be treated as a table or a spreadsheet. So here is a dictionary for the Rotocas language. So just look at the entry for the words ka, meaning to gag. From nltk.corpus import toolbox, toolbox.entries, so rotocas.dict, because this is the language name. So .dict is the extension of that file. So this is how the first entry looks like, entries looks like, right? So entries consist of a series of attribute value pairs such as PS, V to indicate that the part of speech is V verb, and GE gag means indicate that gloss into English is gag. And last three pairs contain example sentence in Rotocas and its translation is Tok, Pisin and English. Then is WordNet. WordNet is a semantically oriented dictionary of English, similar to a traditional thesaurus, but with a richer structure. Anybody who have seen thesaurus in MS Word? Anybody who have seen thesaurus?
No, sir.
Okay, so today you all see the thesaurus in your MS Word. Okay. So thesaurus means, I give you an example. Sometimes you are looking for some synonym corresponding to one word to replace in your document. So thesaurus then provide you the, pardon, yes?
Yes, sir, I have seen that, sir.
Yeah.
Writing the document.
Yeah. So similar meaning words are there, synonyms are there. So you can find out the synonym corresponding to the word that you have used in your document and you can replace whichever you like. And no doubt is fitting into your context of that document. So WordNet is a semantically means meaningly oriented dictionary that is providing you the meaning. Similar to a traditional thesaurus with a richer structure. So in thesaurus, we are getting only list of words corresponding to one English word. But if you talk about the WordNet, so it has a richer structure. It has more information corresponding to that word as well. So NLTK includes the English WordNet in which 155,287 words and 117,659 synonym sets are there. So we'll begin by looking at the synonyms and how they are accessed in the WordNet. This is a very powerful thing. So senses and synonyms. Consider the following sentence, 1A. If we replace the word motor car in 1A with the automobile to get the another sentence, 1B, the meaning of the sentence stays pretty much the same. What is the first sentence? Benz is credited with the invention of the motor car. So now we are replacing the motor car with the automobile. So Benz is credited with the invention of the automobile. Fine. Since everything else in the sentence has remained same, unchanged, we can conclude that words motor car and automobile have the same meaning. They are synonyms. We can explore these words with the help of WordNet as well. So from nltk.corpus, import WordNet as WN. So we have kept alias over here, short name as WN. So we will be referring WN in future when you are using this line. So now WN dot synsets of what word? Motor car. So since, so what it is providing, this is the output, synset car comma n comma car dot n dot 01. The motor car has just one possible meaning and it is identified as car n 01, the first noun sense of car. The entity car dot n dot 01 is called a synset or synonym set, a collection of synonymous words or lemmas. So here you can write WN dot synset, then you are providing this synset dot lemmas underscore names, car, auto, automobile, machine, motor car. So this is the output for this. So each word of synset can have several meanings. Car can also signify a train carriage, gondola, or an elevator car. So however, we are only interested in the single meaning that is common to all the words of the synset. So synsets also come with a prose definition and some example sentences. So definition dot definition, you can find out the definition corresponding to it, and you can see the examples by putting dot examples over here. So any doubt in it?
No, sir.
So although definitions help humans to understand the intended meaning of synset, the words of the synset are often more useful for our programs. To eliminate the ambiguity. So what is ambiguity? What do you mean by ambiguity? Anybody else? Anybody who can tell me what is ambiguity?
Sir, same that example of word saw, sir.
Yeah, that is ambiguity, right?
Yes. Yes.
When we have to put our brains that this word is having multiple meanings and what is the context over here for this word, right? That is ambiguity. So we will identify these words as car dot n dot 01 dot automobile, car dot n dot 01 dot motor car, and so on. This pairing of a synset with a word is called lemma. We can get all the lemmas for a given synset, that is car dot n dot 01. So look at this. So we are providing the synset car dot n dot 01. So it is providing lemma. Which lemmas are providing? Car, auto, automobile, machine, motor car. So then WN dot lemma, car dot N dot automobile. It is providing lemma, car dot N dot 01 dot automobile. Then WN dot lemma, car dot N dot 0 dot this dot synset. So it is providing synset car dot. So what is the synset for this, right? Then if you want to find the name of the lemma, so it will be providing automobile. So unlike the word automobile and motor car, where which are unambiguous and have one synset, the word car is ambiguous, having five synsets. So this is how you just have a look on it, and you can try by your own so that you are able to understand about it in a proper manner. So for the convenience, we can access all the lemmas involving the word car as WN dot lemmas in bracket, you can provide car. So so it has 01 car, 02 car, 03 car, 04 car, and table underscore car dot n. So in this way. So this is the hierarchy. wordnet hierarchy, the wordnets in sets correspond to abstract concepts, and they do not always have the corresponding words in English. These concepts are linked together in a hierarchy. Some concepts are very general, such as entity, state, or event. These are called the unique beginners or root synsets. And others are called the gas guzzler or hatchback and are much more specific. A small portion of a concept of the hierarchy is so artifact, then motor vehicle, motor car, go-kart, truck, motor car, then hatchback, compact, gas guzzler. I hope you are able to understand this. Then wordnet hierarchy, you can just do through the programming. So motor car equal to wn.synset car.n.01, we have stored into motor car. Then motor car dot hyponyms. First we have done homonyms, right? They have the same meaning. Now they have the different meaning, hyponyms. So types of motor car 26, that is ambulance, so sorted. So in this way, you can just find out the hierarchy as well. Then this is how, and again, you can go for the hierarchy. So using hypernym, paths and all. So you can just go through this slide by yourself, and then you can just try by your own so that you are able to actually understand how this wordnet works. So more lexical relations. So when you are talking about wordnet, so lexical relations are there, right? So hypernyms and hyponyms are called lexical relations because they relate one synset to another, synset to other. So these two relations navigate up and down and is a hierarchy. So I think you, if you people have learned database management system in which aggregation and generalization concept is there. Have you gone through any idea? In that we have a hierarchy is there in that triangle shape we use over there is a hierarchy. So if you talk about generalization, so different direction of triangle is there. If you have the aggregation, different kind of triangle direction is there. So another important way to navigate the wordnet network is from the items to their components, that is meronyms. To the things they are contained is holonyms. So for example, the parts of a tree are its trunk, crown, and so on. These are the part meronyms. The substance a tree is made up of includes heartwood and the sapwood. That is the substance underscore meronyms. A collection of trees forms a forest. That is member underscore holonyms. So this is how you can do through the programming. So tree.n.01 is the synset. You are finding the part underscore meronyms. Then you are finding the substance underscore meronyms. You are finding the member underscore holonyms. So just try by your own and you will be able to understand. More lexical relations, you can just go through this website and you, if you actually implement it, you will be able to understand how this all works. You have the relation between verbs, you have the relation between nouns and all. So you can just try by your own. More lexical antonyms are there. You all know about antonyms. You can find out the antonyms from there. So by providing the name of the lemma along with the antonym, dot antonyms. Then semantic similarity can be found. So by hypernyms, you can just use dot synset. You can find out a lot of synsets information in different variables. And then you are just finding out the hypernyms. Lowest common hypernyms, right dot lowest common hypernyms in bracket, you are providing the name of that another synset. Semantic similarity, w dot synset dot minimum depth. So of course we know that the whale is very specific, and whereas vertebrate is more generally and entity is completely general. So we can quantify this concept by generality by looking up the depth of each synset. So semantic similarity, you can find out path underscore similarity. Path underscore similarity. Just try by your own and you will be able to understand about it. So now we are concluding the full section. Over here, a text corpus is a large structured collection of texts. NLTK comes with many corpora, Brown corpora, Guttenberg corpora, News Chat corpora, and so on. Some text corpora are categorized by genre or topic. Sometimes the categories of the corpus overlap each other. A conditional frequency distribution is a collection of frequency distributions, each one for a different condition. They can be used for counting word frequencies given a context or a genre. Python programs more than a few lines long should be entered using a text editor saved to the file with .py extension and accessed using an import statement. Python functions permit you to associate a name with a particular block of code and reuse that code as often as necessary. Some functions known as methods are associated with an object, and you give the object name followed by a period, followed by the method name, like this, x.functy, for example, word.isalpha. To find out about some variable v, type help v in the Python interactive interpreter to read the help entry for this kind of object. WordNet is a semantically oriented dictionary of English consisting of synonym sets or synsets and organized into a network. Some functions are not available by default but must be accessed using Python's import statement. So I think you are getting a clear picture of what we have covered in last two lectures. Is it clear to all?
Yes, sir.
Any